Okay, well, welcome everybody. I'm very, very pleased to see so many people coming to the colloquium. this is a very special occasion, I will say. We have one of the most famous speakers in the world, one probably the leading figure in theoretical high energy physics, giving us a colloquium and about the subject that he has been the leading figure to create it. Juan, I think, is of course doesn't need an introduction at this stage of his career, even though he's very young for my standards. he's already a well-known scientist, and as I say, is one of the leaders in the world in this field. Juan is also a very good friend of ICTB and is a role model for many of the young generations. He's from Argentina, and he told me once something that I use to repeat whenever I have an occasion, is that he became in string theory in great part because of ICTP. So I keep trying to get all that credit, even though a little bit, from whatever ICTP contributed to developing his career. And partly because his supervisor, Gerardo Aldazabal, used to come here very often. He was a postdoc here, and Juan, I think, assisted to the schools and so on. And so being such a good friend of ICTP, he has been helpful in many respects. He's one of the members of our scientific council, which is very important for us, because is the advisory committee that that advises in what lines of research and activities we follow. So he has kindly agreed to be part of that. And more recently, he joined us into one of the most biggest adventures in the last couple of years is to create a branch of ICTP outside Trieste, which is in Sao Paulo, Brazil. And the director is another string theorist, Nathan Berkowitz. And Juan kindly agreed to be the scientist member of the steering committee, which is the governing body of the institution. So in that sense, he has been helping the mission of ICTP in many respects. Personally, I remember meeting him since he was a student, and I was already very impressed by him, and then impressed to see how he developed his career. And maybe many of you may not know, his wife is from my country, from Guatemala, so in that sense, he has been always very helpful in whenever he goes to Guatemala to go and give presentations and give seminars and so on. Some of us in Guatemala made a joke that probably by marrying Juan, Maria, his wife, may be the person that will contribute more to science in Guatemala than any other person. I think, well, it's a pleasure to have Juan here. And as usual, I just met him last week and immediately suggested to give the colloquium. And he said immediately yes, even though he's given two lectures today and two lectures tomorrow. So let's welcome Juan.
Okay, it's a pleasure to be here. Is it on? Yeah. It's a pleasure to be here in ICTP, where, as Fernando said, I was listening to lectures some years ago. So today I will be talking about quantum geometry from field theory, and I'll be describing a relationship between quantum field theory, or theories of quantum interacting particles. Some of these could even be quantum mechanical theory, ordinary quantum mechanical theories, and theories of dynamical space-time. So theories where space-time is dynamical, such as the theory of general relativity. And this is a quantum correspondence. So here we are going to use quantum gravity as defined by string theory. So this goes under various names, like the gauge gravity duality, gauge string duality, ADS-CFT, holography, etc. So these are all various names for essentially the same relationship. Now, so we know that the geometry of space in the early days was thought to be Euclidean in the time of Euclid. And then eventually people discovered non-Euclidean geometries. And the simplest non-Euclidean geometry, the first one to be understood, was that of the hyperbolic space by Lobachevsky. Now, Then it was understood that if we add the time direction, we instead of having Euclidean space, we have Minkowski space. And the simplest, and then it was understood further that the metric of our space-time is one of these non-Euclidean geometries, and the theory of general relativity is really a theory of geometrodynamics where we are looking at the dynamics of geometry. So this theory had two very surprising predictions. The first was black holes, the fact that black holes, stars could collapse into black holes and the black hole solution. And the second one was the expanding universe. Both of these were very surprising predictions, so surprising that even Einstein himself was surprised. Now, Einstein is supposed to have said to Lemaître, who was the one proposing the expanding universe or popularizing it more after, of course, Friedman also proposed it. But so Einstein told him, your math is great, but your physics is dismal. Okay? Now, I like this phrase because that's sometimes what people tell us, string theorists. And we hope to be as correct as Lemaître was. So these were very surprising because both involve drastic stretching of space and time. Now, quantum mechanics, of course, was another triumph of 20th century physics. But general relativity is purely a classical field theory. So the obeys classical field equations. And as any, and where geometry is dynamical, and as any dynamical system, we should be able to quantize. So there should be a version of quantum geometry and in order to properly understand the theory. Now, in general, it's very difficult to change the shape of space-time. So in some sense, space-time is fairly rigid. So all the matter in the Earth here is curving space-time very, very little around us, and we don't even have to go to great lengths to measure the curvature of our space-time. So that's an example of why, well, that's a clear example that it is very rigid. And for that implies that for most situations, the idea of thinking of quantum fields or quantum mechanics in a fixed space-time geometry is a good approximation to physics. And for that reason, we can usually ignore this problem of quantizing gravity for all practical purposes, for most practical purposes. But this becomes a very big problem if we consider the Big Bang. At the very beginning of the Big Bang, we really need a full theory of quantum gravity. Now, even before we go into this full theory of quantum gravity, there are many interesting predictions of quantum fields on a fixed geometry. There are two surprising predictions that can be derived from thinking about quantum fields in a fixed geometry in situations where gravitational effects are important. And these two surprising predictions are related to the two surprising predictions of general relativity that we discussed before. The first is that black holes have a temperature. And the second one is that an accelerating universe, an universe that is expanding in an accelerated way, also has a temperature. So in the case of black holes, the temperature is proportional to 1 over the size of a black hole. So the typical wavelength of emitted radiation will be proportional to the size of the black hole. And in the accelerating universe, the temperature is proportional to the acceleration, which again goes like 1 over the radius of the cosmological horizon of that accelerating black hole. Now, this is a basis for the theory of inflation. It's a theory where there is an expansion of the universe with almost constant acceleration. And according to classical physics, this, if you had that period, it would produce a very large and homogeneous, perfectly homogeneous universe. So that's the kind of universe that inflation would produce classically. So if you ignore quantum perturbations, it produces a completely uniform universe. And those quantum perturbations that we discussed before produce the universe we see, so give small perturbations, which we see here in the cosmic microwave background, And those perturbations then produce are big enough to produce the universe we see, which is not completely homogeneous at short distances. Now, I'm going to present this in a way which is in some sense the end, should normally be presented at the end of a talk on the gauge gravity duality, but I'm going to present it at the beginning as a kind of motivation. So the primordial fluctuations that we see in the sky are nearly scale invariant. Now what does this mean? This means that if we compute the probability or the wave function for a fluctuation of a given length, that's equal to the probability of a fluctuation of shorter lengths. And this is what is seen in the microwave sky, that all that fluctuations are nearly scale invariant. So we have a wave function or a probability amplitude for the shape of our universe, which is scale invariant. Now, scale invariance in physics appears in various circumstances. And what is scale invariant? So I already said it before, but let me emphasize it again. So the idea is that if we rescale all the coordinates, or we look at the same physical system at different length scales, we see essentially the same physics. I mean, one familiar example of scale invariant physical process is the electric force between two charges. It's proportional to 1 over r squared, and that law holds from very short to very long distances. It's the same law. It doesn't have a very drastic change in nature. Now, most of everyday physics is not scale invariant. And so objects we normally encounter come with typical sizes and lengths, and physics is really not the same at, let's say, our scale and the scale of bacteria. Things are quite different, and it's also not the same at the atomic scale. So we have poor intuition, especially for interacting scale invariant theories. Now, some systems in condensed matter are scale invariant, especially systems near second-order phase transitions, such as the liquid-water phase transition, is described by a scale invariant theory where you have fluctuations at all length scales. Or also, you can consider quantum critical points in condensed matter theory, are also other examples of scale invariant theories. Another example of a nearly scale invariant theory is chromodynamics at high energies. So the theory of strong interactions at high energies, it becomes nearly scale invariant. There is a small dependence, logarithmic dependence of the coupling on the energy scale, but it's almost scale invariant. So these are all examples of interacting scale invariant theories. Now, scale invariant theories typically have another symmetry, which is called conformal invariance. So these are transformations which preserve the angles. So they change the local lengths, but preserve the angles between the different lines. This is a picture by Escher where he did a conformal transformation on a picture. But for our purposes, we are not going to distinguish between scale and conformal invariance. There is a small mathematical distinction, but I said this because sometimes in the beginning slide, we talked about conformal field theories. This is what we mean. There are theories that, besides being scale invariant, are also invariant under this. And many theories that are relativistic and conformal invariant are also scale invariant. And there are some general proofs in some dimensions that this is always true. Okay, let's go back to scale invariant functions of geometry. So we saw that the early universe has a wave function, has a probability distribution for geometries, which is scale invariant. And so we will ask the question of whether we've seen this somewhere else in physics. So how can we produce some function of geometry which is scale invariant, which does not depends on the shape, but in a scale invariant way? So one way we can do this is we can consider the following problem. So we can consider a problem, for example, in statistical mechanics or a quantum critical point in condensed matter, so one of these quantum critical field theories, and we can consider it on a general geometry. Okay? So if we consider this partition function, it will be a function of the geometry, and so we'll have a partition function which is a function of the geometry, and it will be a scaling variant function of the geometry. So this is one method of producing a scaling variant partition function. And we could wonder whether by this procedure we can produce the wave function of the early universe, where the wave function of the universe could be given by the partition function of some set of fields on that three-dimensional geometry. Now, we don't know whether this is true or not. Some people think it's true. Some people think it's not true. But this, of course, it would be very nice to have this relationship because it would be a way of computing the wave function of the early universe without necessarily having to, without having to know exactly what happens at the Big Bang. All that would be encoded in this partition function. Now, but we don't know whether this can be applied to our own expanding universe. But this type of relationship actually works for hyperbolic space. So I discussed that hyperbolic space was the first classical geometry, curved geometry that was understood. In some sense, it's also quantum geometry. Its quantum geometry has also been understood. And the Sitter space, an expanding universe, has this metric. Hyperbolic space is a space where, roughly speaking, what happens is this time direction, instead of having expansion in the time direction, we have expansion along a spatial direction. Okay, that's one way of saying this. So it's hyperbolic space where all directions are space-like. That's the space that Lobachevsky considered. And what's called anti-de-Sitter space is the same as hyperbolic space, but where one of these directions is time-like. So it's the Lorentzian version of hyperbolic space. So it's a space with constant negative curvature. So again, we have expansion along a spatial direction. We can also call this expansion a gravitational potential along the extra dimensions, along the rho direction. Now, so the statement that has been understood in the case of this type of spaces is that the wave function of the universe in ideas can be computed in terms of a field theory on the boundary of this idea space. So this is the so-called ADS-CFT duality. So all physics inside ideas can be reduced to quantum field theory that will live on the boundary of this space. Now, the original argument for this was by considering certain objects in string theory, and I will briefly describe this argument here. So the idea was that string theory contains some solitons or some brains, so some solitons that have three spatial dimensions. This is one particular case of this relationship where this... And so these were some objects that were discovered by Polchinski, and they have a very precise definition in string theory. And the same objects, when you put many of them, can be described in terms of a geometry that has the same energy and the same charges as these objects, which looks a bit like an extremal black hole geometry, sometimes called extremal black brain. So if you take this, if you think that these two are related, so you can describe the same physical system, and you take the low energy limit of this configuration, you find that the low energy limit of the system of brains, that whose description, as I said, was very precisely given by Polchinski, is given by a certain supersymmetric chromodynamics theory. So it's similar to the chromodynamic theory of that describes strong interactions, but with extra symmetries. So not identical, but similar in spirit, in the sense that there are fields like gluons with colors and so on, but slightly different in detail, with a symmetry called supersymmetry. And if we have n of these brains, we get we have a theory with n colors. So in chromodynamics, the number of colors is 3, but in these theories, the number of colors is n. So that's what we get when we take this low energy limit. And here, we can, when we take the low energy limit, we are we can be of lower energies in two different ways, either by being waves in this spacetime, but also by going very close to the horizon of these brains, so very deep inside this throat. And there the geometry of space, instead of being 10-dimensional, is has this form of a 5-dimensional anti-Sitter space times a phi sphere. And so the idea is that these two theories should be equivalent. I didn't say, but this theory is a theory defining four space-time dimensions. This is on the word volume of these brains. So we have this four-dimensional quantum field theory, which is supposed to be equivalent to quantum gravity or string theory on ADS5 times S5. So a four-dimensional space that appears here is on the boundary of this five-dimensional anti-Sitter space. Now, to explain more features of how this is supposed to work, we just need to review a couple of things describe a couple of things about dynamics in these geometries, which have this this factor that depends on position. This is sometimes called Bohr factor. We could also call it, as I said, gravitational potential. Notice it multiplies the TT component of the metric, and that's what the Newtonian potential does that. The gravitational potential, you write a metric which is 1 plus the Newtonian potential. That's a small deviation around the flat metric. When we, here we have a big deviation around the flat metric, but nevertheless, the physics is the same. We have a gravitational force that pushes us towards the region where this goes becomes very small, right? Where the gravitational potential becomes deeper. Okay, so a particle is pushed. So if we put a particle at some position in this space, some position rho, in this space, it will be pushed towards smaller values of the gravitational potential or Bohr factor. So this is very similar to. So if we have a person sitting there, this person would feel a constant gravitational force, not very different than the gravitational force we feel here on Earth. Right? So anti-Sitter is kind of the analog of a constant gravitational field. It's a general relativistic analog of a constant and uniform gravitational field. Okay, so that's what we have. Now, that's that was the gravity side. Now, then we can consider a little bit dynamics in scale invariant theories. And one way to study dynamics is imagine you have some system that is described by one of these scale invariant quantum field theories, and you deform a little bit. You deform it just a little bit. What you will do is you will create an object, or perhaps set of particles, that expands. So it will create some perturbation. This perturbation then expands uniformly. And the question is, how do we characterize it? Okay. Now, in theories with a mass gap, massive theories, we know how to characterize small perturbations. They are just given by massive particles. And these massive particles are specified by three positions. So in four space-time dimensions, we have three positions which specify the location of the particle. Okay, and also, we need to give the mass. In one of these scale invariant theories, to characterize the simplest kind of excitation we can have, we should give four numbers. We need to give the three positions and the size of the object that we've created. Okay? And in addition, we should also specify something which is kind of analogous to the mass, which is called the scaling dimension. So how sort of the energy, how things behave as you change the scale of the object. Now, if you look at the book of Landau and Lifshitz in the first chapter in the book of mechanics, they explain how we are supposed to write down an action that is Lorentz invariant for a massive particle. And you find that it's given by the length of the world line, okay? Just based on very generic symmetry principles. Now, we could do the same. So here, we say that we have the three positions, and or we could include time also, and we have the size we're going to call C. And we can write the simplest action that is, both reparametrization invariant under change of tau, and invariant under these rescalings that we talked about. So here, if we rescale x to lambda x and c to lambda c, we see that this action is invariant. So this is the simplest action we can write down. And this action actually describes an ordinary particle in ADS5. So we started by thinking about describing excitations. These excitations in conformal invariant theories are sometimes called unparticles. So they are similar to particles, except that they have one more parameter, the size. And they are the way we should think about excitations in a conformal invariant theory. And so the statement is that unparticles in 3+1 dimensions look like the action of an ordinary particle in ADS5. And well, here we've simply described this from the symmetry points of view, but one can find the precise, even when you quantize this, you can find the precise correspondence between the quantum description of these excitations and the propagation of waves or quantized waves in ADS5. So what we see is that, so I'm going to repeat what I said in the previous transparency, but with a picture. So we have scale invariant dynamics in 3+1 dimensions. In that theory, we have objects that come with different sizes. So we can have the red object is some excitation, which has some size. And the blue one is exactly the same excitation, but expanded a little more. Okay. So in the same way that in ordinary theories, we can have a particle which sits at one position and we can translate it. In scale invariant theories, we have objects of one size and then grow them to a bigger size. So that's the boundary description. The interior description is given by a particle that has a fixed proper size in the interior. It's Compton wavelength, if you wish. And then you can move it along the radial direction. So the direction which I was calling rho before, and now I'm calling c. So it's a direction going away from the boundary. And for c equal to 0, the object, corresponding object, is very small. As you increase c, the object becomes larger. And in the field theory, these objects, once you make them, they will want to expand, and they typically will expand at the speed of light. Here, we have a gravitational potential that will push the particles towards the interior. Now, the discussion I've given so far looks very, very general and would suggest that any conformal field theory would give rise to a gravity theory. And so we can ask whether this is true. And the answer is both yes and no. So the answer is yes, but it can be a very strongly coupled quantum gravity theory. So strongly coupled that it doesn't resemble at all to general relativity. So the first question we can ask is, in order to get a gravity theory, we need that it is a weakly coupled theory, so where gravity waves in nature in weakly coupled Einstein theories are weakly interacting. So whenever the Einstein description is valid, gravity waves interact weakly with each other. So that's the fact I mentioned before, that it's difficult to change the geometry of space-time. So that's one necessary condition to have some theory behaving roughly like Einstein theory. But there is an extra condition, which is that we want really a local theory in the bulk. So some theory where we have a Lagrangian, which can be expressed in terms of local interactions in the bulk. And that it has exactly the Einstein gravity form. So in fact, there are string theories that are weakly coupled, but do not look like Einstein theory. So these are strings where the string tension is very low. And in those cases, it looks different. It's still a weakly coupled theory, but it's not equal to Einstein gravity. So we need these two conditions to get an Einstein gravity theory. And we'll discuss them one by one. So what do we need? What does the conformal field theory have to obey in order for the gravity description to be weakly coupled? Now, first we have to make some kind of translation between the gravitons or gravity waves in the interior, in the bulk, in the geometry, and some property of the boundary theory. So now, in any boundary theory, we have an operator which is the stress tensor. Any local theory, right, in terms of fields that is local, contains an operator which is a stress tensor. And this is associated to a massless spin-2 particle in ADS. Okay? So if you perturb the field theory by inserting the stress tensor operator, that's the same as deforming the geometry a little bit of the boundary theory. You will create an excitation in the boundary theory that can be interpreted in the bulk as a gravity wave that propagates through the bulk. The original perturbation was a perturbation of the boundary metric, and then this perturbation goes into to the bulk. Okay. So weak coupling, as I said, it means that it is hard to change the metric, and the stress tensor two-point function in the field theory is proportional to the derivative of the partition function with respect to the metric, so it's how hard it is to change the metric. And in a theory of quantum field theory, this is proportional to roughly one quantity which we could say is the number of fields. So roughly the number of degrees of freedom that we have in this theory. So if we have a single, let's say, massless field, this n would be equal to 1. If we have many, then this will be equal to many. Okay. So that's the two-point function of the stress tensor. And when we follow this translation that I mentioned here between the stress tensor and the massless spin 2 particle, that this quantity ends up being equal to the Newton constant, well, to this combination of the Newton constant and the radius of ADS. So this is the relation for an ADS-4 example. So it's roughly the size of the ADS in Planck units. So if you want the size of your space to be big in Planck units, you need that the number of fields of the corresponding field theory is large. Okay. So it's a very simple condition. So we need a large number of fields in order to have a weakly coupled gravity description. Now, just to give you an idea of how big this number should be for universes you might be interested in describing. So for example, for the early universe during inflation, this number should be of at least the order of 10 to the 12. And for the present universe should be 10 to the 120. Okay. Now, this condition by itself does not ensure that we have Einstein's theory of gravity. In fact, we can compute the interaction between three gravitons defined in this way. And this interaction is also small when the number of fields is large, but is not necessarily equal to the one we have in Einstein's theory, in the theory of Einstein gravity. And okay, so for that we need a little more, and let me try to explain why it is the other condition, why we have another condition that arises. So let's go back to this picture where we have boundary excitations. Here we have the green and the red one correspond to two particles which are, since these two have the same size, they are exactly at the same radial position. And we have the blue one that is deeper inside. Now, from the bulk, we expect that if these two particles collide, that these two particles can collide, and they are not sensitive to this particle if this particle is very far away. So that's what we mean by locality. So if these two particles collide here, they don't affect at all the particle that is sitting far away. But on the boundary, we have them all on top of each other. So how can it be that they don't interact with each other? Now, you can sort of understand why there will not be little influence between the blue and the red if these sizes are really very different from each other. It's basically, this will be short wavelength perturbations that are on top of a very big wavelength of, let's say, gauge fields, and locally they don't feel, the short wavelength excitations locally don't see these very long wavelength modes. They're like pure gauge for them. That's one way to understand it. However, what is difficult to understand is why you should have a local theory within an ADS radius unit. So if these two particles could be separated by a distance which is short compared to the radius of ADS, then these three things will have almost the same size. However, if the radius of ADS is large, like let's say the radius of our universe, then the proper distance could be very large, right? And you have to still understand why you get the local theory. Now, we don't fully understand what all the conditions are to get the local theory. So I In the future, this talk perhaps could be given and will give you a set of prescriptions and a guarantee that you will get the local theory. So far, we need what we do know is that we need some extra conditions. And one necessary condition is that the mass of the bulk higher spin particles should be very large. Now, why am I talking of higher spin particles? Well, normally in nature we have the spin 2 graviton and no other massless higher spin particles. We have spin 1 and so on, but we don't have some, by higher I mean spin bigger than 2. So whenever I say higher spin, I mean spin bigger than 2. So in nature we have spin 0, we have spin half, we have spin 1, we have spin 2, spin 3 half probably, hopefully will be discovered soon. And but we don't have higher than spin 2, at least not elementary particles. Bigger than 2, such as, well, I don't know, hydrogen excited hydrogen atoms and so on, but they are not elementary particles. Okay, so now this prescription that I told you for generating the stress tensor, so take an operator in the field theory and generate the stress tensor, will also generate a bunch of other particles for each of the operators you have in your field theory. And if you have a weakly coupled field theory, you have a bunch of operators which have higher spin. And so in the bulk, they lead to nearly massless higher spin particles. So something you need is strong interactions so that you don't have these higher spin particles. So to have a theory that resembles Einstein theory, which certainly does not contain the higher spin particles, you should have a boundary theory which necessarily has strong interactions. And so then, if we had such a situation with very strong interactions in such a way that they give a large energy to any elementary higher spin particle, then in ADS we expect to have just the theory of spin 2 particles, and there are some arguments that suggest that perhaps this is enough to give you a theory of gravity plus some extra particles. But yeah, we don't yet have a complete derivation of this, of exactly what is necessary. But the spin is an area that's been explored, and many people have contributed to this, especially, well, Penedones is here in the audience, so I certainly should mention him. Because he has done very nice work on this area. Now, in super, so then we go back to this example of super quantum chromodynamics. So theories of that have higher spin particles are non-local, so they have. First of all, they have extra, so when they are nearly massless, we have some extra gauge symmetries that are almost unbroken. So similarly to how a massless spin 2 particle has this extra reparametrization symmetry, the higher spin particles lead to extra gauge symmetry. And we don't understand all the conditions, but the one theory of higher spin particles that has been constructed has massless. Is fairly non-local in the sense that it's not given by an action with finite number of derivatives. That's point number one. Point number two is that string theory is also a theory which contains higher spin particles. And the limit when the higher spin particles become very light is the limit of very low string tension. And in this limit also, we don't have a sense in which we have locality to distances smaller than the inverse mass of this of the massive string modes. So that's where these statements are based on. And as I said, we don't have a complete understanding of all the conditions we need, but we think these are probably some of the conditions you need. That as soon as all the higher spin particles have high dimension, it's likely that that you have local interactions. And indeed, this gentleman down here have looked at conformal field theories in which you have a small, well, some only some light states, and they have shown that solving certain equations, crossing equations are called of the, for the conformal field theory, they are, you find solutions, you can classify all those solutions in terms of interactions in the bulk, local interactions in the bulk. But, well, as I said, we don't yet understand all the conditions. What we do know are some examples. So let me go now and discuss some examples. So we go back to this example that is one of the is the most studied example, which is the case of supersymmetric chromodynamics. It sometimes goes by the name n equal to 4 super young males. This is an ugly name for such a nice theory, but well, it stuck, unfortunately. In this case, the radius of ADS in terms of the size of the string, so and the size of the string characterizes the mass also of the higher spin particles, goes like the effective coupling of the theory. So the effective coupling of chromodynamics is G, so G is the coupling between the gluons, similar to the electric charge in electrodynamics. And when you have a large number of gluons, the effective coupling is enhanced by a factor of n, because each gluon can talk to n other ones. This combination is sometimes called the Toft coupling. So really, the size of ADS in string units, so which gives the hierarchy between the size of ADS and the mass of the higher spin particles, is proportional to the coupling. So here you see a precise example. So and this relation can be derived by looking at the gravity solution and following the dictionary, the translation for the solution we discussed in terms of black brains a few transparencies ago. So here you see that if you want the size to be much bigger than the size of the string, you need the coupling to be very large. And so you can focus on the simplest spin 4 state, and you find that when the coupling is weak, you can compute its energy at weak coupling using chromodynamics in perturbation theory, and you find that it is fairly small, as expected in general weakly coupled theories. You can also compute it at very strong coupling, where the size of the size of this space is very big, and we can approximate the theory as a string theory in almost flat space. And in that case, we can compute it, and we find that it is very large at weak coupling. And so, one question you can ask is whether this is what it is for intermediate values. And so the if this relationship holds for all values of the coupling, you expect that there should be a curve that you can compute and shows that as you increase the coupling, the mass of this state starts growing and matches what you expect from gravity. Okay. Now, this highlights an important relationship, which is an important property of this duality, which is that when the coupling is weak, one of the descriptions is correct. It's easy to calculate. In that case, it's the chromodynamic description. Gluons are weakly coupled. It's easy to calculate with gluons, but hard to calculate with strings or the quantum gravity description. On the other hand, when the coupling is large, it is difficult to calculate using gluons, but it's easy to calculate using the gravity description. Okay, but this also makes the relationship hard to test, because if you want to test the relationship, you have to do a calculation on both theories at the same value of the coupling. Okay, so we'll return to that. Now, the fact that chromodynamics-like theories give rise to strings, are connected to strings, is something that goes back to an old argument by Gerard Toft. And this argument was the following. So, in chromodynamics, we have gluons, which are particles that carry a color and an anticolor. And those can range over 3 values each in chromodynamics. But we can consider a theory which has n colors instead. And this is sometimes called the Larsen limit. And in such theories, what happens is that you can form chains of gluons where we have, let's say, here one gluon with its color and anticolor, and this gluon will interact strongly with another gluon whose anticolor is related to the color of this gluon. Here in this, I've denoted the colors and anticolors with the same color. I guess too many words the way colors are. but it will not interact strongly with the gluons whose colors are not correlated. So you can form chains of gluons where the colors are correlated in this way, where the anticolor of one is related to the color of the next, and so on. And then the interaction between neighboring ones, so these are neighboring in color space, are very strong, but the interaction with the rest is going to be very weak. So if these two, for example, cross this other part here, they will not interact very much. So this form a kind of string-like excitation. And if we take the number of colors to infinity, keeping chi square n fixed, this is the effective interaction between correlated colors and anticolors. Then in that limit, the theory should become a theory of free strings. This is an old argument that was made in the 70s, but there isn't much more to the argument than what I just said. So this was a picture and a counting of the powers of n in various diagrams, and the statement that it should be some kind of string. But the argument didn't tell you what kind of string it was, okay? It was going to be. So what we see here is that these strings are strings that propagate really in a higher dimensional space, in this 10-dimensional space in this case. And this picture was supposed to be an approximation for quantum chromodynamics, where these closed strings would be so-called glue balls, and open strings would be the mesons. And the string coupling in those situations goes like 1 over n. Now, this is this limit in which we take n to infinity and we treat it in this way. It's called the planar limit. And in that limit, in n equal to 4 super Young Mills, you can actually do the you can do full computations. This is this goes under the name of integrability. So the theory displays a new symmetry, which in this planar limit, which is called the symmetry of integrability, and allows you to actually compute. For example, the mass of this particle we discussed before, and it joins perfectly between weak and strong coupling. So now there are techniques that allow you to do the computation and compare the results you get in weakly coupled field theory to the ones you get in strongly coupled theory. And so this is based on work by several people, and this is the first example of a let's say, strongly of completely interacting four-dimensional field theory that can be solved exactly. So there were examples before in two dimensions, like the Sine-Gordon model or theorem model, etc. But now we have also this example in four dimensions. And the secret really is that we have the theory secretly one plus one-dimensional because we have this chain of gluons or strings. And you solve really the Walsh theory on the gluons or chain of gluons or strings. Okay, so the fact that the gravity description is easy when the coupling is strong has led to some practical applications, because strongly coupled field theory problems which are difficult can be translated into simple gravity problems. Now, you can ask just philosophically, why should strong coupling simplify the problem? Okay, why is it that going to strongly coupled systems could actually make your life simpler? Have we seen any previous time in physics that this happens? And the answer is yes. So, for example, imagine a gas of particles, right? I mean, following all the motion of a bunch of molecules is difficult. But if these particles are interacting strongly enough, you can use the laws of hydrodynamics. For example, if you had a gas, but the viscosity, the interaction was exactly zero, then the viscosity would be infinite, and the laws of hydrodynamics would not apply. So this is an example where zero interactions actually quite complicates the description of what the gas is doing. But if we have some interactions, then we can talk about things like sound waves and so on, because they enable you to have some local equilibrium and you have the laws of hydrodynamics. So in some sense, in these cases, gravity is somewhat analogous to the hydrodynamic approximation to this problem of the gas, except that, well, we are basically keeping some of the low energy modes, but it's... it's of course, this is analogous in general because, well, we have a full quantum description and it's valid within the quantum. You don't need to have a statistical approximation to get to gravity. It's enough to have just quantum mechanics. So you only keep some of the low energy modes in the gravity description. And in fact, in some situations, this analogy is actually precise. So especially when you have black holes and when you have black holes and you consider very long wavelength excitations of black holes, those are correspond to exactly hydrodynamics, as we will discuss soon. So we can consider black holes in ADS. And black holes in ADS are correspond to thermal configurations in, well, black holes are thermal configurations in ADS and correspond to thermal configurations on the boundary theory. And the entropy of these black holes can be computed by computing the area of the horizon and in the field theory by computing the log of the number of states. And in some cases, this computation can be done and compared. It's non-trivial to do it because you have to do it for a strongly coupled field theory, but in some cases you can actually do it and compare and you get the right answer. Now, this is one example where you see that the difficult problem translates into a simple problem. So it's difficult in field theory to calculate this thermodynamic properties of a strongly coupled system, but in gravity it's very simple. You just calculate the area of the, I mean, you calculate properties of these black holes, and you only just solve classical equations. Now, you can also understand some properties of black holes. So the black hole is described by a gas of particles on the boundary, and this the evolution of that gas should be unitary when viewed from the outside. So if you accept this conjecture, this duality, then there is no information loss due to black holes. Okay? But there are some features of black holes which haven't been fully understood. For example, how to recover the interior hasn't been fully understood. And there are still some things people are fairly confused about this, about how exactly the interior emerges. But in the context of black holes or black brains, so you can consider the field theory at finite temperatures, and this corresponds to certain black brains in anti-de Sitter space. And then ripples on the black brain correspond to hydrodynamic modes, and the absorption into the black hole, so these ripples will fall into the black hole, and the black hole will go back to a straight black hole. And this corresponds to dissipation or viscosity in the fluid. And you can compute the transport coefficients, so like viscosity and so on, in this strongly interacting fluid by solving wave equations in this background, and that's relatively easier than doing the calculation in the field theory. So this is, again, one of the practical applications. But an interesting conceptual issue is that Einstein's equations, when expanded for long distances for these ripples of black brains, reduce to the equations of hydrodynamics in this setup. And you can even reduce them to the Navier-Stokes equations by looking at low velocity, doing the low velocity expansion of those equations. Now, I've discussed and emphasized the scale invariant theories, but this gauge gravity duality also holds for non-scale invariant theories. And the story is rather similar. The only important difference is that the gravitational potential in terms of there is again an extra dimension and a gravitational potential in the extra dimension. And before it was a gravitational potential, it was just decreasing as you moved into the extra dimension. But now it's a gravitational potential that has a minimum. And so particles that are in the bulk want to sit at specific locations. There is a special minimum. And so the excitations on this background are, the lowest energy excitations are frozen on this back. I mean, they are not moving along the C direction and behave like particles moving in the ordinary space directions. So objects have a preferred size. So here when an object is here very near the boundary, it's very small, and then here becomes bigger, it has a preferred size. And this happens, for example, in the theory of chromodynamics, it's not scale invariant, and an object like the proton has a preferred size that is determined by the theory. Okay, so in conclusions, we saw that this cosmic scale invariance, except that for negative curvature as opposed to positive curvature, is related to the field theory one. We saw that the quantum version of hyperbolic space is related to conformal field theories on the boundary. And we also saw that it leads to toy models for strongly interacting systems, and they can be used for testing various hypotheses about strongly interacting systems. And some properties have been discovered by using these as toy models. And also, this relationship explains some puzzles regarding black holes. It gives a picture for the black hole entropy, and gave a very convincing argument that black holes do not destroy information. Now, there are various challenges or things for the future. One positive way to put it is that we are just a sign away from understanding the Big Bang singularity. All we need to do is change the description from negative lambda to positive lambda. Okay? And this has not yet been understood, except for one very nice example involving higher spin gravity. But well, it's higher spin gravity. It's not. There is no example yet with where the Einstein gravity approximation is good. But this is at least one example that is perhaps possible to do, change the sign in the relationship. We'd also like to understand, classify the conformal field theories which give rise to large universes, universes where the gravity approximation is correct. And understand black locality, understand the interior of black holes, and so on. And what we see here is that one of the directions of space was not present in the microscope, in the description on the boundary theory, but emerged somehow out of the dynamics of this theory. And so we see here a description where space-time is an emergent concept, and we expect that this is probably a general feature of quantum gravity, that the ultimate description of quantum gravity will not have somehow space-time in the fundamental equations, but that space-time will emerge out of some other dynamics. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Juan.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Juan. It's a great seminar. I'm sure there will be plenty of questions.
About the correspondence between the strong coupling simplifying the problem.
Yeah.
How about taking the example of the superfluid? In that case, the viscosity is zero.
Yes.
So what are you going to say? The infinite interaction in that case?
Yeah. So that's even simpler. So viscosity zero is even simpler.
I see.
No, but I wouldn't say infinite interactions. The actions are finite and strong or whatever. But
okay. Yeah. All right. Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Sorry, and the superfluid, actually, the viscosity is not actually zero. The viscosity is finite for all physical systems. There is viscosity which is typically not below around 1 or 1/10. For all physical systems. When you calculate using black holes, you get that the viscosity is always, viscosity to entropy ratio, I should have said, the viscosity to entropy ratio is always finite and bigger than this quantity I just mentioned, 1 or 1/10. And for all systems which have a gravity dual, and you can trust the gravity approximation, the viscosity to entropy ratio is always is equal to 1/4 pi. And for a while, people thought that this was an actual lower bound, but then examples were found with slightly lower viscosity to entropy ratio. If you use this as a model of the quark gluon plasma, so in the quark gluon plasma or quark gluon fluid, perhaps should be a better name, that is produced in heavy ion collisions, the viscosity that is observed or inferred from the results is also pretty low. It's about 0.2, 0.1. So that is interesting. It suggests that it's described by a strong coupling, strongly coupled fluid. And here we see that this model with black hole even gets into the right ballpark. Of course, we don't know whether for large end limit of QCDs is given by some gravity dual, probably not. But certainly will not be given by a gravity dual where the Einstein approximation is correct.
Yeah. More questions?
So recently, people shown that extreme black holes are unstable with linear scalar perturbations, and people believe that higher dimensional ADS spaces can be unstable. Do you want to comment on that?
That extreme black holes are unstable?
Yeah.
There are extreme. You mean extreme black holes in GR, or?
Yes.
Yeah. No. I think I see. So are you referring to the instability of the Sitter space, anti-Sitter space? Yeah. That's an interesting point. Let me explain what is the statement of what people have argued. So if you have one of these anti-Sitter spaces, and you create some perturbation, you send in some waves, right? If you solve the linear equations, these waves just cross each other without interaction. But if you solve the non-linear Einstein equations with these perturbations, you find that eventually, after a while, you form a little black hole in the center. Okay? So the end result is the production of a black hole. This in the gravity community is called an instability in the sense that from non-singular initial data, you produced a configuration which has a singularity inside the horizon of a black hole. We wouldn't necessarily, in this context, this doesn't represent any bad feature of anti-de Sitter space. It's just saying that if you send in some excitations, they will produce the system with most entropy, and the system with most entropy is a small black hole. So it's relaxation towards the thermodynamically preferred configuration, which is a small black hole. So that's the somehow interpretation of these results. I think this is what you were referring to, right?
Yeah.
Another question?
Is there a simple reason why space-time should be an emergent concept?
Should be?
An emergent concept.
Emergent.
The last. So I'm trying to understand why space-time should be emergent.
Emergent. Yeah. Why? Okay, so it's basically because a point in space-time is not a gauge invariant quantity. So gauge transformations of general relativity change a point to another point, etc. Right? So also localized observables cannot be defined in general relativity for a similar reason. It's likely, so that for this reason, people think it's probable that in a complete description or gauge invariant description of the physics, you don't probably need to have space, but space-time will emerge out of some simpler dynamics or some well-defined dynamics. And the other reason is because it's difficult to quantize directly GR. You will quantize in some other way. Also, when you have singularities, there are many situations like where you have the geometry becomes singular, and this geometrical description is not correct, but you have some other description in terms, for example, of a field theory. that can be applied. So this suggests that space-time is an approximation to something else, some more underlying dynamics, and once you understand the some underlying dynamics, you will understand how space-time emerges. And in this case of the ADS CFT correspondence, you have the, I mean, it's a particular example where this happens, where you have some boundary description in terms of the boundary, and in the boundary description, the interior doesn't even appear, right? And then you get the interior. Now, people have had the idea that perhaps, you know, in condensed matter physics, you can have some microscopic lattice description, and then at long distances, you can have a set of fields and so on, like sound waves, and this might, in some situations, interact with each other and so on. And this is normally called an immersion description, and there are many, many situations where you have this. I mean, superconductivity is another example, or superfluidity, fluidity, etc. So people have wondered whether maybe you start from some lattice description, and at low energies, you get massless gravitons, right? But this, well, this has been an idea that perhaps you can understand gravity and quantize gravity this way. But this idea has suffers from a few conceptual problems. And the first is that the lattice has some notion, fixed notion of points in space and so on, even at long distances. While in general relativity, we don't have such a notion. Also, it violates something called the Bekenstein bounds, which I haven't discussed, which is that the entropy of the number of degrees of freedom in a region doesn't grow like the volume, but it should grow like the area. So these are various reasons why that idea should probably not work. And it's also the reason why people think that if you had some way of quantizing gravity, similar to this lattice, but the final points of the space-time you want should not be in the original description, should emerge from some approximation. And this is happening in this situation. There is another case where it happens, which is called matrix theory, where you describe scattering amplitudes in 11 dimensions using some quantum mechanical matrices, n by n matrices, and taking a suitable large n limit. So that's another situation where space-time is not put in from the very beginning.
Okay, more questions here?
Sorry, my question is about the locality of the boundary theory. In your slides, you had a particle in the bulk, which its shadow was a disk on the boundary.
Yeah.
Do you mean that the boundary theory is non-local?
No, the boundary theory is local in the sense that it has a Lagrangian with local interactions, so that what happens at the next instant in time depends only on what's going on nearby, right? So it's local in this sense. But the excitations that we make are big objects, right? Have some size. That's the size of the simplest excitations. Because if the size of finite energy excitations is always big, it's not infinitely small.
Yes, maybe could you comment a bit on the possibility to establish this correspondence without supersymmetry?
Well, it's, I think, and most people think that it should be possible to do it in cases with no supersymmetry, but it is, well, you can certainly break supersymmetry in a simple way by taking quotient, I'm taking small variants of what I've just described here, but field theories where the supersymmetry in some sense is broken only slightly, and for that, those cases, you can have some sort of relationship also. Those are some examples. Typically, you have to worry about many other things you don't have to worry about in the case of supersymmetry. Like, this theory has a coupling constant, which is fixed, so it doesn't run with energy. Once you break supersymmetry, the coupling constant will start running with energy, as it does in, for example, QCD. But yeah, well, you have to modify these things appropriately, so that. But yeah, it's in general believe that it also will work with supersymmetry. But it's harder to establish and to test. So as I discussed, this test that was done by computing from weak to strong coupling and so on relied on many of the details of this theory.
Questions?
Yeah.
So regarding quantization of gravity, can DSFT tell anything about asymptotic safety?
Not that I know. So, I mean, asymptotic safety is somewhat, I would call it a strange scenario where it goes against the Bekenstein bound, for example, in that when you, the number of degrees of freedom in a region really grows like the volume of the region. And I don't understand in the context of asymptotic safety how you get around this issue, whether effectively some degrees of freedom contribute negatively or there are ghosts and so on. And that's one point. The second is that I don't think it's been shown that the idea even works because, I mean, when people have discussed some two-loop computations in GR, but at two loops, the GR is essentially finite up to some field redefinition. So you really would need to go to higher loops to really see whether the idea in principle works. So.
Yep. More?
So people often talk about a DSFT dictionary. So for binding quantities in a boundary theory, and people tell us how to compute them in a box theory, but. Is there much better if we only have very few principles? Then, about other things in this so-called dictionary by some first principle competitions?
Right. So, if I understood the question correctly, is that when people describe it, they talk about a dictionary where you, given some quantity in the boundary theory, you have a corresponding quantity in the bulk. Yes, that's what people normally do, and you have to work to build this dictionary. Now, the general principle underlying this dictionary is what I said about the wave function, that the wave function is related in the way I've mentioned here. And in principle, from there, you can deduce most of the entries of the dictionary with some work, and it typically has taken some work to be able to deduce the various entries. And even right now, there are some that are conjectured to be correct. We're not absolutely sure they are correct. But the dictionary is it's becoming bigger and bigger.
Certain further implications, especially now people are thinking about duality between the scattering amplitude in ADS and the main amplitude and CFD correlators on the boundary. I wonder if unparticles could fit into this picture or not.
Yeah, I mean, this is just the name for this for what operators on the boundary are. I mean, operators on the boundary create something called unparticles. This is just a fun name. I'm not sure it adds very much. I mean, it's one of the first entries of the dictionary was understood. It's just one way to think about it. I mean, an ordinary particle in ADS is the same as this object that you have. What I wanted to emphasize here is that in the same way that in ordinary field theories, we have massive theories, we have particles with some mass. In scale invariant theories, we have these objects called unparticles. And the important part is that they are characterized by one more parameter, right? That corresponds to the extra dimension. That's what I wanted to emphasize. the natural appearance of the extra dimension.
I have a question myself. Why is it that in your list of challenges you didn't mention the possibility of proving or establishing the conjecture?
Well, yeah, there is that, and probably there are more. Well, part of the reason is that, I think, strictly speaking, I don't think it can be proven. because the gravity side is not defined. So one of the sides is not defined to the level that... So the gauge theory is better defined than the gravity side. So proving in this context would be showing that, for example, the whole string perturbative expansion agrees with the planar diagram expansion of the field theory. And yeah, certainly that would be wonderful. But I think all these results already in the planar theory, I would say almost prove it. They prove it at tree level, if you wish. Simple genus diagrams, genus zero diagrams. The people are building up towards trying to understand it at a higher genus, considering more complicated problems like correlation functions of operators and so on, which are still genus zero, but if you understand this well enough, you might be able to do even at higher genus using integrability. That you would be able to prove in this particular case. Now, of course, you would like to prove it in general for all possible cases and so on. That would be wonderful, and to have a proof which doesn't rely on a case-by-case scenario. So ideally, you would like to have a situation where you are given a gauge theory and you can immediately derive what the corresponding string theory is. I think we are somewhat far from that. Though there are some versions of this duality which are which relate topological theories on the boundary to topological strings in the bulk. And in these cases, you can actually find the rationale for the relationship and understand it much better. This is some work that Gopakumar and Bafa did.
Okay, well, so before we finish, just let me remind you that for those of you who are not used to our colloquia, the next step is for essentially everybody to go outside and have some refreshments, except for the students, or our students, to come down and then have more questions to Juan, where they will not be embarrassed by just everybody listening to them, except for the speaker. So having said that, so let's thank Juan again for the wonderful talk.